If I ever leave this world and you have to come see me laying in front of a pulpit, I pray they sing that song. Hey, I didn't come to Jesus because I needed a new car. I didn't come to Jesus because I needed money. I didn't come to Jesus because I needed a wife. I came to Jesus because I was a sinner. And I was broken. And I tried it all and I couldn't get no relief anywhere else. And 32, almost 33 years later, that water is still as good today as it was the first day, Brother Thomas, I drank it. It still refreshes when you're in the wilderness and desert. It still clears your mind when you're cluttered. When it's 1 in the morning and you can't think straight, all of a sudden you drink that water. And the peace that passeth all understanding comes upon you. And then when no one's around and your companion is asleep and your hound dog has done went into his house, I find myself lifting my hand and saying, thank you, God, for that water. God bless you this morning. Can we give God another hand clap of praise in this room? I had a thought the other day and I thought, you know what, that'd make a good message. If I could put it together, it was a thought I had. Thank you. I was walking through the woods. I was on one of my trips. And, you know, when you get to praying and seeking God, you hear Satan talk to you too. Come on, somebody. Am I right? He don't come a lot of times when you're on top of your mountain and you're shouting good and all your bills is paid. He knows when to stay away from you. He comes when you get something dug into your side and when the bank gets slippery and you're trying to get up, you can't get a foothold. Come on, somebody. I was way back on Stevens Creek, 8 hills over from somewhere, taking a walk. I heard Satan say, you won't ever make it to that city. You'll never hear him say, come on in. Thought to myself, I didn't say this out loud, but I thought, you know what? By faith, I'm going to make it. Come on, somebody. I've got a blessed hope in me, and I believe I'm convinced that I will go. But I thought in my mind, I said, you know, God, I've never seen that land, and I don't know. I pray that I've done everything that I could, said what I could, done what I could, live like I should. But I had this thought. I said, God, if I stand before you, you will never be able to say to me, I never knew you. Because I've known you. Hallelujah. You might send me away, but you will never be able to say, I never, glory to God, I never knew you.
Because you've known me, and I've known you. And if you send me away, it will not be on that basis. It will be on some other pretense, but it will not be on the fact that you have never known me. How many is glad for the fact that you know him? How many is glad that he knows you? Hallelujah. How many is assured without a doubt? He knows who you are. He knows where you live, and he knows what your name is, and he knows what you're facing right now. Hey. That's almost all of the battle won right there. I may not always know the way, but he knows the way. I made a comment one time in a funeral service. I thought to myself, I don't know where that came from. It came from deep inside of my spirit. Turn with me to 2 Timothy while I'm talking. I said this in a funeral service, these words. I later wrote them down so I wouldn't forget them. When you can't see his hand, you can trust his heart. And they sometimes you can't see his hand, but you can always trust the heart of God concerning you when you are his child. And if you can say, Pastor, there's been days I didn't. If I went on seeing his hand, I would be left out. But I trusted his heart. I trusted his word. And it was enough to keep me. I want to talk about something today that every person under the sound of my voice, regardless of how spiritual, how enlightened, how gifted, how charismatic, how anointed, you are. You face this from time to time. It is a general enemy. I'm not trying to downsize this, but it is a general enemy in the fact that it, and every one of us at times and every person in the world faces what I'm about to say and preach on just for a few minutes. Some face more of it in degrees, more in percentages, 10%, 15, 20, 30. Goes up. And I think the bigger the threat you are, the more you face this enemy. If you are a threat to Satan, you face this enemy more and more. But to some degree, every person under the sound of my voice and in this room faces this enemy. I want you to read it with me, along with me here in 2 Timothy. 2 Timothy chapter 1. Beginning in verse 3. Do you have it? Say amen. I thank God whom I serve with a pure conscience, as my forefathers did, as without ceasing I remember you in my prayers, night and day. Greatly desiring to see you, being mindful of your tears, that I may be filled with joy. When I call to remembrance the genuine faith that is in you, that dwelt first in your grandmother Lois and in your mother Eunice, and I am persuaded is in you also. He's talking to Timothy. This is the very last letter that the Apostle Paul penned before Nero cut his head off in Rome. Verse 6. Therefore I remind you to stir up the gift of God which is in you through the laying on of my hands. Let me read that again. Therefore I remind you to stir up the gift of God which is in you by through the laying on of my hands. Verse 7. For God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. My thought today is simply this: facing fear. Facing your fear. Let me tell you, I don't care who you are in this room. There is something that happens to each of us as human beings that causes dread and anxiousness. It could be a thought, it could be a scene, it could be a gesture from another human being. It could be a word from another human being. It could be a dream that continues to reoccur in your nighttime of sleep. It could be an animal. It could be anything that is used to bring fear and dread into your life. Matter of fact, fear is one of the first things that enters into Adam and Eve as they sin against God. Matter of fact, I'll prove it to you. When they sin against God and they eat of that God said not to, and the day you do, you shall surely die. Satan tricks them into believing that they will become God just like God is God, and they'll know all things. He lies. His manipulation is to bring you into an arena where he is in control. In the garden, God was in control as long as man stayed in the position that God had promised him and planned for his life. The moment he believed Satan over God's voice, he done what Satan said. That's the moment he moved out from underneath the jurisdiction of God, underneath the jurisdiction of Satan. And there he began to fall. He began to become complicated in his mind. Well, what if he's right? What if these things are true that this serpent is telling me? What if I do eat this? What will I become? What will happen? When they eat of that fruit, I won't go into a lot of detail, but something happens that never happened to Adam and Eve before in their journey, in God creating them for his good pleasure. Because the Bible said that each day that God came and he talked to Adam in the cool of the day, his voice walked in the garden. Think about that. I mean, he was there. It was Adam didn't have to knock on the door to come into the house. He was in the house and God was in the house and they were co-fellowship and they were cohabitating together. There wasn't no separation between God and Adam. But the moment he believed Satan, something happened. It don't say it, but it happened. Fear entered into to Adam and Eve's life immediately. How do you know that? The Bible says, somebody say the Bible says. The Bible said that when they sinned, that God came that day to talk like other times. And he said, Adam, where art thou? And Adam said, behold, I am over here and I'm hiding. And God said, why are you hiding? He said, because I am naked. I am afraid. Fear had entered. It was Satan's plan to put fear between us and what God had for us. Thus, when fear entered in, we became more attached to the things around us and to Satan's rule. Because it is Satan that drives fear. It is Satan that brings fear. Fear is not of God. It is of Satan. Somebody say amen. And there fear entered into Adam's life. And he said, I'm naked. God asked him, he said, well, who told you you were naked? Basically, fear had, yes, the knowledge of good and evil had came to him because of his disobedience. But doing that, fear was right behind that. The fear, the dread of dying, the dread of being caught, the dread of someone is watching, the dread of being found naked, the dread of I'm wrong and I need to hide. Are y'all with me? Say amen. This fear entered in, and it didn't just touch Adam's life, but every human being after Adam, it began to affect our lives. And I can tell you right now, ladies and gentlemen, that fear is still a part of a real world in our life, regardless of how spiritual and how full of the Holy Ghost and how much we pray and how much we read our Bible, that because of Adam's failure and Eve's failure, fear is still at times a dominating factor in our world and keeps us from doing the things of God. Am I right? Does every person in this room understand what I've said so far about your fear. Now, I'm not trying to belittle your intelligence here, because I feel like I'm right down there where you're at on your level. But it doesn't matter who you are or what you have or what you possess, rich or poor. Fear is a part of human living. And if you don't understand that right off the bat, that you have an enemy and that is going to try to stop your efforts and your life, your children, your process, your progress, your productivity, the things that get the visions, the dreams that God has for you. Fear is always standing there saying, you cannot. There's too much against you. You're not good enough. You're not whole enough. You're not well enough. You don't have enough money. You come from the wrong side of the track. You ain't got the best right last name to go there. They won't loan you any money at the bank. You can't get that job. You're not educated enough. You're not married. Well, you've been married 5 times. You've never been married. It doesn't matter where you are. Satan tries to use that fear tactic to push you back. And in this case, can I preach a minute? In this case, Paul is writing to a young, timid, wet behind the ears, but anointed preacher. And an old, seasoned apostle has to tell him, listen, God has not given you a spirit of fear. Now, when you're young in the Lord, you can become rattled. Matter of fact, when you're old in the Lord, you can become rattled. But what we have that the adolescents in Christianity don't have, and I'm talking about seasoned saints, is that we have victories under our belt. We have times of song and glory that has already passed, and we have lived long enough to come through some of the battles and storms of life and say, he hath brought me a mighty long way. Whereas the young Christian has not seen as of yet the great power of God in which he can employ on your behalf and part the waters and calm the seas and create something out of nothing and make a way out of no way and pay your bills when you ain't got the money and put food on your table when the 7-Eleven's already closed, but some kind of way bread showed up at your house. Oh, you got to understand, it is in that time and in those seasons that as you collect trophies, as I call them, in your faith, it's the one thing that is an antidote against fear. And if you collect enough trophies and enough badges and enough medals on the faith of your life, then when fear comes knocking at the door, I told this to Sister Emily not long ago. Her and I were chatting about some things, and she had shared to me about fear. And hey, we all had that. I shared, hey, I got my own. But I told her these words. I said, listen, when fear knocks at the door, let faith answer the door of your fear and say, hey, who are you? You come down here to tell her what? You come down here to tell me what? You come down here to convince me of what? Oh no, I've got enough places I've already been. I've won enough battles. I've seen God move. I've seen his hand. I've touched the glory. I know where I'm at. I know where I've been. I've not always had it together in my mind, but it ain't about having it together in my mind. It's about believing that word when my mind is spinning. Hallelujah to God. Because when fear is trying to rob me of my victory, faith steps up and says, step back, because the Lord is not through with what he's doing. Hallelujah. Now let me preach a minute. That was all free. He's not given you a spirit of fear, but of power. Come on now. And of love. I like this. And of a sound mind. God knows some of us need a good running overdose of that. Sound mind. The translation is self-control. Sound mind. Self-control. losing, the fear of losing and the thought of losing and the failure at times of losing control. I know none of you have ever lost control. Don't all y'all shout me down at one time. Have y'all ever lost control? Well, I've got 10 honest people. The rest of you need to have a sermon online. Because if the truth is known, all of us at times have lost control. And I'm not talking about flying off the handle. That's a difference. I'm not talking about cussing your neighbor out and then apologizing. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about losing control where you feel like you cannot make it any longer. When you cannot function any further. That you have given completely out of praise and faith and victory. That you are slowly dying and fading away. Oh, yeah, Brother Rod Baker told me this morning, he said, you know, Pastor, people don't understand about conditions in your heart and your body until they have went through them. And he hugged me tight in the office, and after we'd prayed, and he said, I love you and I pray for you. And he said, I understand, because that man right there has had heart problems and open heart. And I've not been that far yet, but he understands, hey, this is what happens when things fail and we pray and it still ain't sure what it should be. I mean, have you noticed lately that everything you prayed about hadn't come to pass yet? But in that waiting for it, fear comes knocking and says, hey, you'll never get that. That's what I'm trying to get across to you here today, is that waiting process on it to come to fruition and to come to manifest itself as a promise from God that is just a thought one day, but then one day you get to hold it in your hand, you get to see it, you get to know the results of it. It's waiting in between the promise and the product, hallelujah. And in between that, you have to face fear and you have to face anxiety, you have to face anxiousness, and you have to face the enemy, and demons come and they try to tell you to step back and don't believe, hallelujah. But you got to have enough forthrightness about you and stamina in your faith to say the devil is a lie, hallelujah to God. It doesn't matter how I feel or what I see, the Lord's word, hallelujah, is that I stand upon, hallelujah. Hey, I'm facing some things right now. I ain't even going to go into detail. I'm facing them now. And my wife told me the other day, she said, I don't get it. I'm like, don't get mad at me. She said, I don't understand it. I'm praying for you every day. And she's like, it's almost like the more you pray, the worse I get, ain't it? She said, you're right. Well, stop praying. I thought, no, I ain't asking her that. I'd rather have prayer and be in the battle than have no prayer and have the battle. Are y'all with me? Kind of reminds me of a little lady that came to our church some years back. She started visiting and she became a member. As she became a member, and I say this with all respect, don't take this out of context, all hell broke loose in her life. She come to me in my office one day, upset, mad, aggravated, you name it, she was there. She's ready to call the overseer on me. My blessed God, everything in my life gone completely wrong. I said, well, let's pray about it. No, she said, here's the deal. I had a pretty good life till I showed up at Sweetwater Church of God. I looked at her. She said, yeah. I said, really? She said, I joined this church and everything wrong started happening. My health went. My husband's health went. We got in trouble. We had to sell our house. Got broke. Ain't got no money. I'm listening to her and I'm like, she got a point. She got a point. She said, y'all need some answers, preacher. Why my life like it is, and it was all right, and I was going to another church, and I was fine. Boy, it's quiet in here, ain't it? I was fine and dandy, sitting on the pew, living it up, the blessings of God. I was healthy. My marriage was good. We was making money hand over fist. But no, I had to come down here and join this church. And Satan said, it's rocked my world. She said, I need some answers. I said, me too. She said, but what we going to do? I said, you're going to go pray and I'm going to pray. And hopefully by next Sunday I'll have some answers. If not, give me a few more months. I'll have some. Well, that week I took a trip, a little walking trip. I had that family on my heart. I said, God, she's got some points. She's got some legitimate questions. And I know where she came from, and she was doing good, and they were making money hand over fist, and everything was going good, and they showed up here, and it's like a lot of everybody's telling me the devil come out the closet. And it was fine as long as I wasn't here. What is up with this location? I'm like, God did say it's a legitimate argument. This is exactly what God said to me. And I'm bringing it into this sermon as a point. He said, you tell her this for me. I said, okay, I'm listening. Because I got a bunch more that's got the same question, and I'm going to relay it to them. He said, you tell her that the problem she's having, they will come in anyhow. And he said, if I'd have left her in that dead church, she'd have backslid. But I moved her to a live church so that when the storm passed, she could be alive and praise me and bless my name. Can I tell you something right here? Don't blame where you are or what's going on in your life. Just be thankful that you're somewhere where the Holy Ghost is moving and you can feel his power and know that when I come through this fear zone and this trouble, I'm going to come out with glory and victory. I'm almost through, and I ain't even started. Oh, my. Let me just skip a little bit. You don't need that. Maybe you need this. You don't have to be constantly beat down by your fears. The Word of God has the answer. Somebody say amen. Throughout the Word of God, continually, you will hear two words said by God to those who are in the greatest dread. Fear not. Any interpretation needed on that? Fear not. Say that with me. Fear not. Hallelujah to God. God has made this appeal and has given the commands to his believers since the day he spoke to Abraham. Whoo! Fear not, Abram. Genesis 15:1, write it down. Fear not, Abram. I am thy shield and thy exceeding great reward. From Abraham to John on the Isle of Patmos, the Word of God rings with these words, hallelujah, to him. Fear not. What God commands, he is able to perform. Let me say that again. What God commands, he is able to perform it in your life. What God commands, hell cannot push it back. He cannot tell you you can't have it. When God commands, fear not. It comes, hallelujah, even when the storm clouds are thick and heavy. Praise be unto God. What God commands is paramount to a promise. God will not command you to do anything that he will not furnish the grace for you to carry it out. Let us notice a few in the Bible, in this word, just very briefly here, where he says to them, fear not. I ain't going to throw it all, but I'll throw a few, enough out there to choke fear for a moment. Isaac, in Genesis 26 and 24, I believe, He says, fear not. Oh, my God. You need to get this in your spirit. Fear not, for I am with thee, and I will bless thee. Look at here. If you ain't got but one verse of scripture you learn all year long, you need to learn that one. Fear not, for I am with thee, and I will bless thee. Let me tell you right now, when you shove that under Satan's nose, hallelujah, and you say, according to this holy Bible, that is a promise not just to Isaac, but his descendants, and Abraham was his daddy, and Abraham is my daddy, because he was the father of faith, and that faith that was in him is living inside of me. Fear not. Anybody feel like shouting yet? Fear not. I am with you and I will bless you. Well, we get over into Jacob's life. Jacob is afraid. I can't go down there. There's too many down there that's against me. God responds to Jacob in 46 of Genesis, chapter 46. He said, Jacob, fear not to go down into Egypt. Hallelujah to God. Fear not to go down into Egypt. Fear not to go down into Egypt. I got it under control. They're not going to harm you. I got this. I got this. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If you walk through the valley of the shadow of death, the psalmist says, thou art with me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thou art with me. Daniel. In Daniel 10 and 19, he says to him, O man greatly beloved, fear not. Fear not. Ooh, when you get that, I mean, when you really get that, Shane, you can make a lion a pillow and sleep on him without the fear of him making you suffer. When you get the understanding that God is in control of your life and your situation, all you need is them two words, fear not. I will be honest with you. I think there's so much talent that is in Sweetwater Church of God at times, and I look around, and you are your biggest enemy to complete it. And to come to the grips that you are who you are. And the reason you got fears and you got anxiousness, you got ideas, you got thoughts about what people will think and what would they say. Well, I don't want to take over. I don't want to say nothing out of the way. I don't want to do this. I don't want to. I watched the commercial last night. And I thought, there's a message in this, and I've seen it 100 times, and you possibly have too. This guy sitting by the pool with his friends, he looked at him, he said, I ain't never getting married. Then he's at the thing picking out a ring. That guy said, that's a pretty ring. They on the plane, he's on the plane with his wife. He said, we ain't never having kids. Next thing you know, she's laying on the back in labor. You seen that commercial? Oh, yeah. He said, we ain't never moving to the suburbs. He's got a townhouse in the city. All of a sudden, you see him in the suburbs out there trimming the hedges. Minivan goes by. He said, we ain't never having one of them. Didn't you see him washing that minivan? Then he says, we ain't never having no more younger than cleaning crayon off the wall. She comes by and says, well, I'm pregnant. Oh, my God. Let me tell you, if you spend your life worrying about things that you're trying to control, you just need to let your life, hallelujah, shine and give it unto God and let God work out the mess that you feel like that is there, because all things work together for the good of them that love God and the called according to his purpose. Have y'all seen that too? I thought they are messaging that. I ain't never doing that. I ain't never. You ever said that? I ain't never doing. I ain't never going there. Next thing you know, you there. Well, I'm here. I said, hey, get this. They ought to make one on me. I said, coming up, I ain't never going to preach. There ain't enough There ain't enough angels to tie me down, my God, to make me preach. I ain't buying no suits, and I ain't subjecting myself to that like my mom and daddy did and go through all the torment that I watched them go through just to preach the gospel, and nobody cared, and nobody paid them no attention, and nobody gave anything to them. And you think I ain't about to do that? You look where I'm at. Never say what you ain't gonna do. I said, don't you ever say what you ain't gonna do. And through that time, you better believe I faced my fears. I faced some fears. I've been among men who were twice as smart, 10 times as smart as I am. And I look and I'm intimidated by them. They got college degrees. They ask me, when did you graduate from Lee College? I avoid the question altogether. Well, let me tell you what happened the other day walking through the woods. They don't understand that. They got this cronyism about them. They understand 4-year degree and bachelor's degree in theology. They got bachelor's degrees in homiletics, and I ain't got nothing. And I stand there and I'm like, oh God, I ain't got nothing to offer. And I look on the inside, hallelujah, and I got a pot of oil that's in the inside. Are y'all with me? Say amen. I got a pot of oil, and fear says you might as well back up, and my oil said you might as well step up, hallelujah. And I say, oh my God, don't back up. Step up. I don't know if I need to say this out loud or not, because I ain't even committed to it yet. But I had a person, Sister Tracy knows her. Thank you for giving her my number. Wave at me back there. She called me yesterday, and she said, we would like for you to come to a certain location for some graduates. Because each year we pick a motivational speaker to come and speak to the graduates. And I'm thinking, I ain't no motivational speaker. I am a preacher. And there is a difference. I said, there is a difference. And she said, I would like for you to call me back and let us set it up so that you can come and on graduation and speak to these graduates. And I'm thinking, what do I got to say to them? Because I quit school in the 11th grade.
Why is it so quiet in this room?
I quit school in the 11th grade. And by counselors and different ones in the school, they couldn't convince me to come back, but they convinced me to take my GED, which I did and passed, thank be unto God. And I'm thinking, I never graduated. Hey, and if you got an education, hallelujah to God. I look, Darla, where you at? Darla, you in the room? No, Darla. She gone outside. Clemson graduate. The greatest place on the planet Earth. Mike Brazel don't say a word. He likes Columbia and William Bryce. God grants forgiveness for people. I talked to Darla and Michael, and they both graduates of Clemson, and I'm thinking, man, I'd like to went there. I'd like to go there. What if they accept 52-year-old guys in Clemson? Do you know what? If you look back, you will keep looking back. And you'll live all your life with fear and dread what you should have done. But God can take what no one else would even give the time of day for and put it in His hand. Just take that clay a little while and roll it, mold it. I ain't never been to a homiletics class, but I'm in His hand. I don't have a degree in theology, but I'm in. Are you in his hand? I've known fear, but I've known faith more. I'm in his hand. So long as I know he cares for me. Fear not. There's a lot of things we fear. Fear of the past. Fear of the future. Can anyone tell me what the greatest fear of mankind is? Fear of public speaking. I got that one accomplished. It's over for that. I could speak to anybody, anywhere, at any time, in any location. You don't believe me? Follow me around sometime. I'm telling you, I can. Fear of the past. Common fears of our day. Some people seem to be unable to forget their unpleasant experiences and blunders of their past. They just seem like they can't let it go. Have you ever been there? Have you ever been there? Failures, mistakes, difficulties, they hamper. They break down our self-confidence and our confidence in the Word of God. This is the reason the Apostle Paul said what he said in Philippians 3 and 13. Write it down. Forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth into those things which are before us. Forgetting what is behind you. And I'll be honest with you, sometimes that is a larger task than what we realize. Forgetting our past. There are victories, and I say rejoice in them. If there are failures in the past, through Christ we can conquer them. We can conquer them in the present. Hallelujah. The fear of the future. Write it down. Second thing, fear of the future. Jesus said there would be a day when men's hearts would fail them for fear, looking after those things which are coming on the earth, the future. World affairs, tensions, pestilences, earthquakes, wars and rumors of wars, famines, Zika virus. If you ain't heard of that lately, you really got your head in the sand. Every scientist in the world right now, every one of them is coming together trying to figure out how we can combat this pandemic possibility that shall come from this. Let me tell you something, ladies and gentlemen. I pray if I got enough blood of Jesus in me, if a mosquito that's got Zika bites me, he'll get saved. Hallelujah to God. He'll suck that blood in and say, my God, where'd he get this from? Because this came from another world. Hallelujah to God. Let me tell you, I can't live my life based on the fear of what the liberal media is telling me. Hey, our country is upside down. We're looking at the possibility of a total shutdown on Wall Street. Some are saying, our president, hey, the choices, look at them. My God, have mercy. We need to pray. But I'm telling you right now, fear could easily grip us all, but my eyes are upon Jesus Christ, and I got my mind made up. Hallelujah to his name. Fear of the future. We don't have to worry about it. Jesus said in Luke 21:9, when you hear wars and rumors of wars, be not terrified. When you see these things being to come to pass, then look up and lift up your heads, for your redemption draweth nigh, verse 28 says. There ain't no reason to be looking down today. Sure, fear is still in our world, and it still grips our heart. But there's something stronger than fear, and it's called faith. And there's something stronger than faith, and it's called hope. And there's something greater than either of them two, and it's called love. And when you get that, and you know that he loves you, in spite of what's happening, you will overcome every fear. Because the scripture says in 1 John, perfect love, what does it do to fear? Oh, my God, cast it out. You ever seen somebody cast something out of the house? It's something that you don't want. You don't walk to the door and just shake that thing off. Casting out has this word of forwardness about it. It's an action word. It's that little rat you find dead behind your counter you didn't know, and you don't even want to pick him up. When you do, you don't pet him or try to resurrect him from the dead or nothing else like that. You take him and you cast him out. Because dead rat, alive rat, they rats, and I don't care nothing about them. And you cast them out. You get them as far away from you as you can get them. And that's the whole concept about fear and love. They cannot abide in the same location. When you are filled with love and his love, fear says, well, there's no vacancies in this house. I have to go somewhere else to live because every room is filled and occupied by love. And let me tell you something about love. It is the number one thing that we crave in our lives, and that people will spend millions and billions. They'll spend all their inheritance just for someone to say to them and to make them feel loved, because we are creatures of his creation that have to have love. We have to have that love. And there's something about not being loved that will torment you, and it brings fear. People that are not loved or feel less loved have a greater battle with fear than anyone else, because fear understands that they feel like they're less loved, then they got occupancy in their life, and I can move right in and inhabit that space where love should be. I'll just create a domain of fear, and the next thing you know, you're fearing everything, fearing relationships, fearing something new, fearing changing a job, fearing going to the bank. Next thing you know, it grows.